Hi, it's Michael from the Red Chair Diaries, Bedford, Nova Scotia. It's the 6th of October. So this is my video daily in October, number 6. I did a response to somebody else's video log, but I won't count that. Anyway, I want to continue the theme of people that I admire. And for those of you who have never been to my my blog as opposed to my video blog, my blog is also called the Red Chair Diaries, and then I have a second one called Scatter Shots, and that could be anything. The first one's basically about me and my trip as a gay man, as opposed to my journey. And the third one is called Private Lives, and that's about books about people and books about people. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen me allude to this book, The Naked Civil Servant, by Quentin Crisp. I'll try to remember to give you a link to my blog about that, because I think he was a very interesting person. He died well over a decade ago, maybe even longer. Came across him in 1977. That book I purchased in 77. And I just devoured it so quickly. He gave himself a nickname in that book, that he was one of the stately homos of England. Now, I mean, sometimes the British sense of humor tends to escape me, but not in this case. His writing were hysterical. His writing's hysterical. He was hysterical when you saw him on television. He did a lot of interviews. And toward the end of his life, the last decade or two, I think he was living in New York City. Still never had a lot of money, but he started making a career out of just giving speeches. You know, like, he was an extremely camp figure. And I've been thinking about this because of the Eric's blog earlier about, you know, gay guys are masculine and all that sort of stuff. So, anyway, there was not a masculine bone in Quentin Crisp's body. Not one. You try to find one. He couldn't find one. And so he talks about growing up between the wars, basically, I think, before the Second World War, and how they could be prosecuted in England. But everything he said was hysterically funny in that book. You've got to find the book. You know, it's got to be someplace. And I came across it because a documentary was put out. Or not, I guess you called them a bio-doc or docu-drama or something like that. But anyway, John Hurt played him in a story of his life. And that's also going back to the 70s, and what a movie that was. But this guy, he literally just said things that we don't agree with now that are just totally politically incorrect, like, yes, I was worthless, I was a homosexual, yes, so of course it was natural that people would beat me up, and things like that, and that's not funny out of context. It's funny in context as a matter of survival. I mean, he's talking about a place where you could go to jail for being gay, remember? England was not kind at that point. And some of my correspondents tell me that it still has an awful lot of homophobia that is basically swept under the rug over there. This is the first paragraph, and this sets the tone for the book. I mean, you really have to have a liberal sense of humor to understand how hysterically funny this book is from beginning to end, with an incredibly serious topic, okay? From the dawn of my history, I was so disfigured by the characteristics of a certain kind of homosexual person that, when I grew up, I realized that I could not ignore my predicament. The way in which I chose to deal with it would now be called existentialist. Perhaps Jean-Paul Sartre would be kind enough to say that I exercised the last vestiges of my free will by swimming with the tide, but faster. In the time of which I am writing, I was merely thought of as brazening it out. Now, if you can find another gay memoir that is able to fit in Jean-Paul Sartre in the same paragraph, actually the same sentence, basically, almost the same sentence, as alluding to one's own incredibly feminine characteristics, I challenge you to present it to me. But this guy, the title comes from the fact that at one point the only way he could make a living was by being a life model in art classes, you know, getting money from the public dole, more or less, to do that. And he was no beauty. And I suppose the best life models aren't, you know. So I think one of the points he makes in the book, if I can recall that far back, pardon me, is just had a cup of coffee and beautiful homemade cookies from Ted, and now I'm ready for another nap, and it's 7:30, so there you go. Anyway, sorry about that. If I recall correctly, I was saying is that he makes the point that since he wasn't good looking, people could concentrate on the art lesson. Now, I just find that stuff very funny. It's, like I say, it's all politically incorrect, but if you get with him, you get with his vibe, as particularly when you actually saw him interviewed, you just go along for the ride, because he makes very, very serious points, incredibly serious points. But he says, I am what I am, basically. That's what he's saying. I am, I was, I shall be. I'm not changing. I cannot change. And that in itself is political activism, as far as I'm concerned. As he got older and older, I mean, he was older when we first came aware, basically, maybe my age when we first became aware of him, his hair got light, whiter, and the color cast got more lavender. So you'd see him, and he'd have basically gray hair with a beautiful lavender tint to it as he was being interviewed. I mean, what can you do with that? And he says I remember one sentence that I have never forgotten, and I chose to live by, since I don't dust my library very often. I don't think I've given this place a good dust in a year. And he says, no, I don't dust. I found out that after 4 years, it doesn't get any deeper. Now, that is a sentence to remember, and I certainly remembered that one. Anyway, I really, really suggest that those of you out there who have screamingly funny senses of humor and who like the sort of thing David Sedaris does, and the stuff that John Waters, the filmmaker, writes, his books are fantastic, really. You know, they're very, very subversive. Fran Lebowitz, that type of thing. They write sections, they write short stories, basically, of observations, okay? This is a memoir, and you don't find the other people writing memoirs so much as they write observations, and this is not a thick book. I mean, it is about 200, maybe 20 pages, but it is very small print, so, you know, it'll take you a day to read it. Just kidding. Any page you turn to, this page 86, one fact became inescapable. Homosexuals were ashamed. They resented not being in the mainstream of life. The feeling varied from irritation to the anguish of irrevocable exile. It had little to do with God or the neighbors or the police. It was private and irremediable. See, there's an awful lot of truth to that. And I think his book might have been written in the 60s. No, it's copyright 1977. No, copyright 1968, yeah. And it issued in Fontana paperback 77. So I read it in 77. And highly recommend it. The Naked Civil Servant. Quentin Crisp, Quentin Crisp. And I'll put a link to my typed blog about that from last year, I think it was, earlier this year before I was doing YouTube. And you can and get some more details. And there's actually a video there that I pulled off YouTube that is an interview with him. And you know, as functioning gay activists, you really must know some more and more and more of our history. And that's my lesson for tonight. I will shut up now. And it's Michael from the Red Chair Diaries. Don't eat anything bigger than your head. And I hope you come back for more. Bye-bye.